Let me invite you to the book of Colossians. We are continuing our study in this book. Last week we wrapped up our five-part series on the family, and so we're going to continue on in chapter 3. As you're turning there, this last week on the Ask Pastor John podcast, he was asked a very interesting question, and may have Ed put it up there. Let me read it to you. I think it's relevant for what we're going to be studying in the book of Colossians today. This is what was sent in. Pastor John, hello. As a Christian at the end of my life, have I really done all that I could have for Christ if I don't become a martyr for him? I'm currently working in a skilled trade, and by all accounts, I'm climbing the ladder of success, so to speak. But a few years ago, I began to feel that God was calling me into a path that might be deeper and more directly impactful for the kingdom. I began to feel as though a life spent in the workforce or corporate America was a waste of time and energy. I've spent several years trying to figure out God's calling on my life. So far, to no avail. My question is this. If I spend my life in a career that does not have the direct mission of spreading the gospel, isn't that wasteful? Why would God place me in a job that isn't involved in expanding his kingdom, but rather consumes my energy in material production? And more directly, have I truly done everything, used every ounce of strength, given every fiber of my being to the kingdom of God, if I don't become a martyr for Christ? Now, this is an episode number 1503. It's about 10 minutes long. If you're interested in how John Piper answers it, I think he gives a very wise, very helpful answer. I'm not going to recite it for you, but I bring up this long question that's, if you look there, at the center of it, is at the heart of it, right? If I spend my life in a career, excuse me, see if I can fix this. If I spend my life in a career that does not have the direct mission of spreading the gospel, isn't that wasteful? In other words, is most of your lives a waste? Right? Moms, is what you do for your kids for, you know, like 16, 18 years, well, longer, right, if you have multiple children. Or those of you who don't have kids, you know, maybe you work as a nurse or you work as a teacher at a secular school, dads who have businesses or engineers or whatever else, if it doesn't have the direct impact, is that a waste? Is what only counts the ministry you do here within the walls of this church or any church that you could come to? In other words, this question touches upon something that is very near to every single one of us, and that is, what does a life in service to Jesus really look like? If you see there, it's kind of reflected in my title, A Life in Service to Jesus. So here's the question. What does that life in service to Jesus really look like? Now that's the question that I think Colossians chapter 3 in our verses helps to answer us. Now before we do this, I want to invite you to bow your heads, and I recognize my own limitation and weakness and an ability to bring what is needed to you, and I want to ask every single one of you to just bow your head and ask the Lord to speak to you today. As we look at these verses, we're going to talk about some things that are well known to you. But ask for the Holy Spirit to speak so that you would see the relevance of His Word into your life and making your life much more filled with the service to our King, who is Jesus. Let's pray. Father, we know that Your Word is living and active. We know that it is sharper than any two-edged sword, and that it can pierce to the division of our soul and spirit, to our very being. And it can help to discern the thoughts and intention of our hearts. And right now, we ask that You would just do that for every single one of us. And as You penetrate, You would bring life and light. For the glory of Jesus' name, amen.
Now, I know that we've spent 5 weeks talking about verses 18 through 21. Now, the reason I'm looking at this bigger section is it's actually a thought unit. Verses 18 through the beginning of chapter 4 are what's known as household codes. In other words, they tell people in households how to live together. In fact, there's a few of those, few of them throughout the New Testament. And if you ever noticed, it's always wives, husbands, children, parents, slaves, masters. If you ever wondered why that was the case, was ancient households were very different. They consisted of a much larger group of people. It was the father, his wife, his children, and probably other families. And not only other families, but it was also the slaves and the servants and those who helped run the household. So when Paul is addressing here in this section, why it's always like this, is he's talking to families and he's telling them, what is their life supposed to look like in a family? We will be focusing a little bit more on verses 22 through chapter 4, verse 1, and we will actually come back to this passage next week as well to talk about some other things. But today is going to be kind of a flyover. So let's take a look with this question in the back of our mind. What does it mean to live a life in service to Jesus? Verse 18, wives, submit to your husbands as is fitting in the Lord. Husbands, love your wives and do not be harsh with them. Children, obey your parents in everything, for this pleases the Lord. Fathers, do not provoke your children, lest they become discouraged. Bondservants, obey in everything those who are your earthly masters, not by way of eye service as people pleasers, but with sincerity of heart, fearing the Lord. Whatever you do, do your work heartily, as for the Lord and not for men, knowing that from the Lord you will receive the inheritance as your reward. You're serving the Lord Christ. For the wrongdoer will be paid back for the wrong he has done, and there is no partiality. Masters, treat your bondservants justly and fairly, knowing that you also have a master in heaven. I trust you've carefully read that. You saw it. If you didn't, you didn't see it on here. You have a pew Bible. You can open it up. But as you look at that passage, what do you think is at the heart of what the Apostle Paul says? What is that one thing that if you were to remove out of this passage, it would just go flat? It would remove the whole idea, the whole intention of what Paul is trying to communicate. What is the glue and the lifeblood of this text? Let me show it to you. Let's go back to verse 18. Let me show it to you. It's repeated multiple times. What is the motivation given to wives to submit to their husbands? As, verse 18, the end of it, as is fitting in the Lord. How about the children? Verse 20. Children, obey your parents in everything. For why? For this pleases the Lord. Right? How about slaves or bondservants, as the ESV translates here? Bondservants, obey in everything those who are your earthly masters. Why? Fearing the Lord at the end of the verse. Whatever you do, do your work heartily as for the Lord, not for men. Now, the husbands, the fathers are like, hey, we're off the hook. Now, keep in mind that in the Roman family, the father, the husband, he had total authority and control over his family. And so Paul leaves the best for last. And in chapter 4, when he says masters, it's referring to the patriarch of the family, the husband, the father. And he says, treat your bondservants justly and fairly, knowing that you also have a master in heaven. In other words, husbands, why do you love your wives? Fathers, why do you not provoke your children? Masters, why do you treat your slaves fairly? Because you're not the ultimate master, and you will give an account to the Lord. By the way, this whole passage is built around this idea of motivation for being a, as we talked about, a spirit-filled husband, a spirit-filled wife, a spirit-filled parent, child, slave, and master, as we'll talk about next week. In other words, where it all begins is that Paul is calling us first and foremost to be motivated by Jesus. Motivated by Jesus. What does a life of service to Christ look like? Well, it begins not with the what you do. It doesn't begin with whether you are martyred. It doesn't begin with the amount of time and energy you spent at the church. It doesn't begin if you're on the mission field. It doesn't begin if you work for a nonprofit. It rather begins with the why. With the why you do what you do. For every single one of us, there's a drive. There's a motivation. There's a reason behind everything that we do. And as we've been looking at this passage, we've seen that it is pregnant with practical instruction for how we are to live life in the family. I mean, we've talked to the kids, right? Kids, you got a whole sermon to yourselves about your obedience to parents. Husbands, wives, parents, we each got a sermon about what are we to do. But as we step back and we take a look, that what really holds us together is why we do those things. Husbands, do you love your wives so that you would have peace in the home? So that mama would be happy and so everybody would be happy? Do you love your wives because that's the norm maybe in our church, hopefully? Fathers, why do you not provoke your kids to anger? Is that so that you'd have a good relationship, you could influence them? Now, in some ways, I don't like those false dichotomies, but ultimately, we actually have to take a step back, because the point behind all of those things about spirit-filled wife, husband, and so forth, a spirit-filled life, is about whether you and I are pursuing to be submissive and honoring and glorifying to our Lord. This is the motivation that holds everything together. Now, as I've said, household codes or expected norms of how life was supposed to happen were very common in the ancient Near East. In fact, the ancient Near East, kind of like the East nowadays, is quite a bit different from our world, you know, where, you know, if you live in a regular neighborhood like I do, the typical experience is that, right, the garage goes up, we drive in, we close it, and you might catch a glimpse of your neighbor, hear him mowing the lawn or something. Right? We're much more of an individualistic society. Our family is just us, our wife, maybe kids if we have them, right? The in-laws and others, they live elsewhere. Unless you're very wealthy, and even if you're very wealthy, you probably don't have servants living with you. They maybe come to your house, just clean it once a week or whatever. The ancient world was very different. Everybody lived much more together, a couple of generations. By the way, right, if you are into like Jane Austen novels or the Victorian era, right, if you've seen any of those movies, there's always this tension between masters and servants, and there's always like this measurement. Why? Because that was the normal course of life of having this. And so Paul here is addressing this household reality. Now, there's surprising, if you look at these household codes, there's surprising continuity and there is shocking discontinuity with what was expected. In some sense, for wives to be submissive, for children and slaves to obey in everything, that was in continuity, that was the society expected. But also, shockingly, the obligation to the husbands and fathers is really countercultural. I mean, we'll talk about this next week, but the bondservants, the slaves, they were seen as animated tools. In other words, they had no moral value. What do you mean treating them justly? How do you treat a hammer justly, right? It made no sense. If you read this in conjunction with Philemon, which was the two letters were sent to the church in Colossae, right? Paul says, treat him as a brother. Like, how do you... So it's very shocking. It's very different. And Paul is calling us not simply to live in a certain way so we fit in society, so that we would be different. It's not to fit in, it's a Christian mold or something, but it is about the master whom you and I serve. In other words, are we seeking to please Jesus? Are we seeking to be pleasing to him? Now, as a personal experience, when we hear that, quite often for most of us, that can introduce a level of paranoia. Or maybe the way that I grew up, or sometimes the way that I've heard these things, where you can almost become paranoid about your walk with the Lord. Oh no, my motivation's a little bit off. Oh no, am I really doing this to please God, or am I doing this to please myself? And you're constantly walking on eggshells, right? What if I'm a little bit off? Is God pleased with me completely as I would like him to be? And what I want to insert here is that the point here is not to insert paranoia so that you would be walking in eggshells, not sure if you're doing everything right. It's rather to give you and me freedom. Here's what I mean. As we look at the world around us, we're bound to be impacted by what the norms and expectations that there are. Is our car in line with all the other cars in the neighborhood? Right? How does the size of our house compare to everybody in the church? How does my how does my kid's behavior at church service compare to the other kids? I'm a pastor, right? My kids are supposed to be the most obedient. To be sitting there, right? And they're just like, you know, as if I've inserted three shots of coffee right before. But right, society around us puts norms and expectations on us, and we are prone to ask ourselves naturally, how do I fit in or how do I fit in? And more so, we're prone to say, I'd like to be just a little bit better than everybody around me. And what that means is that inevitably, we become slaves. We become enslaved to those norms. And you know what happens? It's ever-changing and it's ever-subjective. And if the husband and wife can even have these different norms, the wife might think this is the norm is to be spending this much time because one of her friends is their husband spends X amount of hours with them and takes them on these types of vacation, and why are you not doing this? The husband is looking at the other saying, hey, I'm providing you for a better house, a better car than these people. Do you see what I'm saying? The motivation is to fit into these outside norms that very often have very little to do with the Bible. They may not be anti-biblical, but they might not have very much to do with following Christ. And what Paul is talking about is a much more simplified denominator. He's talking about seeking not to please the society, seeking to please some sort of norm, but he's asking in what we do and what we're pursuing, the dreams that we're building, what role does Jesus play into that? Does he really play a role in those decisions? Does he really play a role in those expectations that you and I set for ourselves? When I watch my kids go over benches and things like that, am I worried more that they're distracting to people? Or am I worried that you guys are going to look at me and think I'm a bad parent, for instance? Right? How often I can react as a parent because I feel like the behavior of my children is a bad reflection on me, and it's much more of a shame and a fear driven rather than responding to them because I want them to honor and live for Jesus. Right, and you can see how this can go wrong and awry in so many directions in terms of looking at church ministry and service. How much do we want to be a church and doing things as we should be, as we ought? But how much of that is moved and motivated by the fact that we want to get some sort of special place with God? To feel a little bit more secure about our eternal salvation. And Paul begins, and time, I hope you see, he says, you're doing this in the Lord. You're doing this to please the Lord. You're not doing this to please men, but please the Lord from whom? And keep in mind, masters, those who are given the responsibility to govern your households, to lead your wives, to take care of your children, and others below you, keep in mind that you're a manager at best, and you have to give an account to how you have treated faithfully those under your charge. And are you being selfish for your own ends, for your own gains, or are you doing it for the Lord? In other words, we are to stop and consider something that we know very well, but this idea, are we living a life that is motivated by Jesus? That's what it means to live a life in service to Jesus. That means to be motivated first and foremost by Him. Now here's the second aspect as we take a look at this passage. The second aspect is this. See every aspect of life as relevant for serving Jesus. I read this to someone, they said, this is wordy. I am wordy, sorry. Gets the idea across, I think. But this is the second thing. I don't know if you've noticed. This is actually quite fascinating. Up until this point, if you remember, I mean, we've been in Colossians for some time, but up until this point, Paul has focused on general attitudes that are very practical, but they're kind of applicable to everyone, right? I mean, if you just go back a little bit, verse 5, put to death, therefore, in chapter 3, what is earthly in you, sexual immorality, impurity, passion, right? Verse 9, do not lie to one another. Verse 12, put on as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, compassionate hearts, kindness, humility. Right? This kind of applies to us all. And then he begins and he zeroes in on this idea of the household where there's specific roles, specific responsibilities, specific callings, actually a lot of mundane stuff. I mean, in some sense, after Paul talks about all of these things, it almost makes sense that Paul would make a bigger call now for people to commit their life to missionary work, to become martyrs, for people to become Bible translators, to become those who are going out into unreached places. But it's fascinating. The only individual group of people that Paul addresses in the letter of Colossians, and actually most places, has to do with these family codes. Why does he get into this nitty-gritty? I think the reason for that has to do with the fact that Paul doesn't simply understand the reality that most people will not be going. Most people will not be going overseas. Most people will not be directly involved in, you know, full-time ministry. I mean, to say that, hey, I am, you know, well, I sing in choir and I give 4 hours of the week, or I lead a group, or that's a very small part of life. And if that's all you think you're doing for God and you're good, I mean, hey, I feel pretty good as a pastor. Right? Why isn't Paul calling more people to full-time ministry? Are we kind of on a platform above all of you here? No, Paul understands something really important. That whether you're a pastor, whether you're a stay-at-home mom, you're a student, you're a business owner, you're a teacher. He understands that most of life is actually lived in the mundane. In places that are not directly related to gospel work. You know, I do think this is why Paul actually, throughout this text as we went, he reminds those who are more in the subordinate position, if I could put it that way, right? He talks about the motivation for wives directly, motivation for children and slaves, right? Those who kind of have least, in that society anyway, they are the people that would have least opportunity in a certain sense to do big things for Jesus. In other words, what is important for Jesus? What is important for Jesus is not only the great things you and I may do, but the faithfulness we display in the mundane. In other words, is just as much of a service to Jesus, dads, if I could pick on you for a moment, is just as important for you not to aggravate your children as it is for you to evangelize your Muslim neighbor. It is just as important for those of you who are business owners to evangelize your coworkers or whatever, those who are under you. It's just as important to treat them justly and with equity as it is for you to tell them that they need forgiveness of sins. You might want to ask, what does that mean a little bit more? And here it's very interesting. Take a look at verse 22. I just want to zero in a little bit. Paul talks to sort of those who are in this category, on the bottom, you know, on the bottom of the totem pole, the bondservants, the slaves. Now look what he tells them. He says, bondservants, obey in everything those who are your earthly masters, not by the way of eye service, right? Meaning when they're watching you. I was actually using that word, there's a word eye in there, ophthalmos. Not by the way, not when they're just watching you as people pleasers, right? I'm going to do a good job. I'm going to do a good job at work so I could mainly get a promotion. But with sincerity of heart, fearing the Lord, with a purity, with single-mindedness, to please the Lord. Now look, if you think this is only about evangelism, do your work, whatever you do, work heartily. By the way, it's very interesting. It's a good translation, but the word there is not heart. The word there is psuche, which is soul. Do your work from the soul, from the very inner being of who you are, as for whom? As for the Lord. In other words, look at what you're doing. Moms, look at that stinky diaper that you have to change, that your husband doesn't want to help you with. Not a commentary on my family at all. Right? Look at that as for the Lord. We're not used to maybe thinking in those ways very often. Look at that homework that you have to grade, that room that you have to sweep or vacuum again. That is for the Lord. As for the Lord, not just for the house. And God uses that. God is pleased with that. In fact, He put you there for that purpose so that in His own mysterious way, He will use that for the greater purpose of the gospel that you may not see right now and you may not see until later. You know, it was so interesting to read commentaries in this passage because one after the other, they say things like this. Putting the life of the new age into practice begins at home. Putting the life of the new age into practice begins at home, not on the mission field. Isn't that fascinating? He's saying, you've been brought to life. We've talked about this. You're a new creature, you're a new creator. You've been created in you by the Spirit of God. You live in the kingdom of God. You have His Spirit. You have a new life. Start at home. Another commentator says, Paul here makes clear that the call to the Colossian believers to set their things on the to set their minds on the things above. You all remember probably chapter 3, verse 1. Set your minds on the things above, right? He says he's remind that the call for the Colossian believers to set their minds on the things above does not mean that they can brush aside their family obligations below. There is no opposition between above and below. In a Christian worldview, you cannot be so heavenly minded that you're no earthly good. If that's the case, then you're not heavenly minded nor earthly good. These come in concert. The point here that Paul is making, as he's breaking down, as he's following on the family, as he's focusing on the family, on these mundane things, is that we serve Jesus in daily lives, in the mundane, when we serve the family, when we're faithful spouses and parents, when we're good masters, bond servants, everywhere. Do you know what this points us to? It's a very simple reality that while from our human perspective there may be no direct impact from the gospel, from the divine perspective there is always a direct impact on the gospel when we live faithfully in the circumstances, conditions, gifts, times, phases of life. Let God take care of the direct. Focus and rejoice in the faithfulness. Number three, we took a look at two. This is the third, this is the last. All right, what does it mean to live a life of service to Jesus? Look at verse 24. That's where I want to zero in for this closing line. Knowing that from the Lord you will receive an inheritance is your reward. Thirdly, expect. Expect Jesus to reward you with an internal inheritance. Expect Jesus to reward you with an eternal inheritance. It's fascinating that Paul says this to slaves. Guess who in the ancient world had no inheritance? Had no concept of inheritance. You know, it's kind of like, I reflected on this. I mean, the correlation is very, very thin. So hear me out. It's very, very thin correlation. But you can hear my, you know, those of you who are Americans, you can hear my accent that I'm not American. My family moved here, and as I got older, went to school and things like that, and there's, you know, these students that I studied at school with, and they like get inheritance, you know, like trusts endowed to them. They have money for school, right? Or some of you are, you know, waiting for your grandparents to die, right? Because there's an inheritance there waiting for you. I had no such concept. Like, I love my parents. They've given me way more than I could ever hope for. But after they pass, there's nothing coming in for me. In a small sense, for the slaves here, it was much greater reality of that. I mean, they were owned. Their children were owned. There was maybe some little hope that they could somehow work out and become masters, but there was no inheritance coming. And Paul, particularly to them, he says, as you're working for the Lord, as you're not working pleasing, as you're not trying, you know, you're not trying to be the best slave so that you would get the best treatment, but you're doing your work as for the Lord, knowing, verse 24, knowing that from the Lord you will receive an inheritance. On earth, yeah, you might not get anything. You might not be freed and so forth. But there is an inheritance waiting for you. You have comfort. You have peace. That this short life of yours will end and you will have an eternity in inheritance. Now, by the way, if you remember, when we studied Hebrews chapter 11 a few weeks, and faith, 11:6, without faith it is impossible to please Him, meaning God. Remember this verse. For whoever would draw near to God must believe that He exists. What else? And that He rewards those who draw near to Him. Now, as I took a look at this, one of the things that's kind of frustrating is that this is found even in Colossians 1, if you take a look there, it talks about the inheritance. If you read Colossians chapter 1, you read Ephesians, 1 Peter, other passages of Scripture, 1 Corinthians. This language is common as a factor for the believer to know that there is an reward. What's somewhat frustrating is that nobody really says what it is. Even Paul here says, you have an inheritance waiting for you. But Paul, what is it? Like, what are we waiting for? There isn't much. But let me take you to Galatians just to show you a little bit of what this might be. Galatians chapter 3, Galatians chapter 3, verse 18. Here Paul is talking about law and gospel and how faith plays into that. In verse 18, chapter 3 in Galatians, says, "For if the inheritance comes by the law, it no longer comes by promise. But God gave it to Abraham by a promise." In the logic of the passage, you could read it, we are children of Abraham. We are children of Abraham by faith because Abraham obtained the inheritance by faith. And here's the clue. What might that inheritance be? And this is where we could turn back to a passage like, for instance, Genesis chapter 12, where God makes His initial promise to Abraham. And let me just take a look, because this gives us a perspective a little bit of, you know, what are we talking about here? Chapter 12, verse 1. Now, the Lord said to Abram, beginning in verse 1. Go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you, and I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great, so that you will be a blessing. And I will bless those who bless you, and him who dishonors you I will curse, and in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed. Now, to careful readers of the Bible, they understand that the Bible doesn't begin in Genesis chapter 12. And especially if you begin your Bible reading plan at the beginning of the year, and I would encourage you, maybe do that today. Read Genesis 1 and 2 and Genesis chapter 12. Because what God is ultimately promising Abraham here, he's promising the way back to Eden. That's what God is promising. What is the inheritance? The inheritance is not simply eternal life, not simply peace with God, though that is at the very heart, but it is that in the afterlife, you will enter a place of heaven that is made perfect, where all injustices are done away with, where all the tears are wiped away, where all the pain and sorrow and sadness and disease and evil is thrown into the lake of fire. It is a place of where you get to reign with Jesus in the heavenly city. Right? What Paul is doing here, and we've talked about this, but what Paul is doing here in the midst of our life, he's sort of bumping our chin up and says, look up. Look up. You're so busy. You're so busy with kids. You're so busy with careers. You're so busy with vacations. You're so busy with making a name for yourself. You're so busy with getting stuff. Look up. Look to the end. There's an eternal inheritance. All the stuff you are so consumed with and by which you measure your life, it's already yours in the perfect sense in the afterlife. It's broken here. Your brand new car, it's going to have very expensive oil changes and it's going to break down. Your big house, you're going to drive your wife nuts cleaning it all the time. Your careers and all of those things, put them in perspective. Put them in perspective of the reality that, are you really pursuing them for the Lord? Are you seeing them in service to the Lord? By the way, there's nothing wrong with having wealth, having new cars, or whatever. I've said this before, but right, there's a sense in which God has always, beginning in the New Testament, Old Testament, and New Testament, God has used people who are wealthy in order to continue his plan of redemption. In some sense, if there was no wealthy people, no wealthy believing people, we would not be standing here. I mean, not just as a church, but I mean as Christianity. Because of their faithfulness, of how God blessed them and giving them back. But the point is that for all of us, that's right, those of us who are not wealthy, we just think that if only. And God says to these slaves who had no hopes, like we do, who did not grow up with an American dream presented to them in every billboard and screen, but who had doom and gloom in front of them, Paul says, lift up your chin, look up. There is an inheritance waiting for you. And so as we faithfully work, as we faithfully apply God's standards that are going to make our lives different, uncomfortable, weird, they're going to be out of sync with the culture around us. Paul is saying, there is, expect, Jesus will reward that. Let me have that question back up there from the very beginning. And if you can put it up there. If I spend my life in a career that does not have the direct mission of spreading the gospel, isn't that wasteful? What does a life in service to Jesus look like? It looks like to have a right motivation. It looks like seeing that every aspect of life serves Jesus and is expecting that reward of inheritance, eternal, unchanging, unbroken inheritance from Him. And let me give you a moment, just on your own, bow your heads and come to God and bring whatever is there. Take a moment and ask the Holy Spirit to take one, two things. Maybe there's something you have to repent of. Maybe there's something you have to thank God for. Maybe it's something to ask God to change in your lives. Let me give you just a moment to do that, and then I'll invite you to stand and pray together. Father, we thank you. We thank you that our lives matter to you. We thank you how you've created us. We thank you that from the very little things to the big things, whether they're done within the walls of this building or outside of them, those things matter to you. And if they're done faithfully for your sake, you will use them for your kingdom, for your glory, for your gospel. Lord, I pray, that you would give us faith to see that, to pursue that, to love that. We want to live lives in their entirety in service of our great and precious Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.